about a new mentorship offering that I have that I've been doing for a handful of speech therapists and just wanted to share about it with my email list and social media, however you're contacting ABA Speech. So I'm happy that you are here with us. If I'm new to you, I'm a speech therapist and a BCBA, and I have worked in the public school setting and also divided my time between the non-public setting or ABA centers. And if you really follow my content, you might know that in May, I stepped away from my school-based position to work on all things ABA speech. So we're an ASHA provider, we're an ACE provider. I do a lot of mentorship and consultations, which I'm going to be sharing about. And I have a podcast, Autism Outreach. When I am not doing all of those things, I am spending time with my kids. And I always say, I hope you don't get to meet them because they are out there with my husband right now. So let's keep it that way. We are all on a journey. This is me, my very first year as a speech language pathologist 20 years ago. Can you believe it? 20 years ago. And they called me the speech teacher. And we are all on a journey. So I have this little visual here. So this is your turn to participate. And I'm wondering, let me know right now, are you a speech therapist who's working in an ABA setting? Let me know in the chat. Or are you a BCBA who's a clinic owner who might want to offer some support to their speech therapist? So let me know in the chat if you're a speech therapist, and let me know in the chat if you're a BCBA, and let me know, are you working currently in an ABA setting? So it doesn't have to be an ABA clinic or outpatient. It could be just that they're using ABA in your school setting. Okay. ABA classrooms, SLP. Okay. Oh, Jacqueline's here. Hi, Jacqueline. How's it going? SLP and ABA classroom. Okay, wonderful. So I'm happy that you're here. Welcome. Okay. And Kinsey's an SLP and ABA clinic. So, you know, I'll never forget in one of my first meetings at the ABA center that I worked in for almost 20 years. And this was about 20 years ago. I remember hearing words like manned, tact, echoic, being thrown around by coworkers in a meeting. And I just sat there nodding my head like I knew exactly what they meant, but really I had no clue. And so I went back to my office and got on the computer, just like any person probably would, and started to Google and sort out and find blog posts and information about what all of these jargon type terms meant, because I really was not sure at the time. And I don't know about you, but when I find something that I don't know how to navigate, I feel very defensive about it. And I feel like I should know this. Why don't I know this right now? This wasn't the first time that I felt confused when I started working in an ABA center as a speech therapist. There was also the time that I got into, let's call it a professional disagreement with a BCBA over programming a student's AAC device. And I could go on and on about some of the difficulties that I had with collaboration over the years before I was both a speech therapist and a BCBA. And even after I was duly certified, I still get into some of these situations. Being the only SLP or an SLP in ABA setting can be lonely and feel very isolating at times. So many questions to ask, and no one to really ask them to. And so it can be really hard to know how to navigate that type of setting if you're unfamiliar with it. And with the way that insurance covers ABA, our field is just growing at such a rapid rate. So being a speech therapist in an ABA setting can be a very wonderful and rewarding experience. And I would never trade the experiences that I had, but I did learn a lot along the way that's very specific to working in that setting, because it is very different than anything I've ever done. So let me know, just to kind of gauge, does your SLP collaboration sometimes feel strained? Just let me know in the chat, yes or no, sometimes. And maybe you're not even working with a BCBA, but let me know, is your SLP BCBA collaboration challenging or overwhelming, let me know in the chat by letting me know yes, no, sometimes, yes. Yes, 100%. Sometimes. Okay. Yes, at times. Absolutely. It can feel that way. No. Okay, good. Feeling isolated. Yes, not usually. Well, that's good. And I love collaboration. Obviously, I do a lot of training and talking about that, but it can be difficult, especially if you're an SLP in an ABA setting and they've never had an SLP before. That can be extremely tricky too. And I made this little TikTok about it. You should be able to hear the sound, but even if not, it's just a little video. Okay, that's just a joke. Some SLPs and some BCBAs get along, but we do have different training and different backgrounds. So we may come from two different thoughts about how to solve one problem. We know that we want to help a student increase their communication skills, decrease unsafe problem behavior. The way that we might think about doing it might be different, and that's okay. We don't have to always think the same way either. That's the thing too, is feeling comfortable advocating for why you're setting a goal and feeling comfortable advocating and asking, well, why did you set that goal? Why are we doing that? Why are you setting the goals for a COEX or verbal limitation? Why are you, the BCBA, doing the programming of the device? I mean, those are just questions that come up. So I've been there. I spent the first few years of my career as a speech therapist in the ABA setting here in Cleveland with the Cleveland Clinic, and it was overwhelming. I mean, I had a lot of questions, no one really to ask for help, no support or guidance. So I really dug into the science of applied behavior analysis, and I did become a BCBA myself. So I've been duly certified 10 years, which I'm not going to lie, that does make my collaboration that much easier. And it allows me to help speech therapists and BCBAs work together collaboratively, because when we work together, we can just help our students in such an impactful way. So being one of less than 500 people who are both an SLP and BCBA, I've really made it a big part of my life's work at ABA Speech, hence the name ABA Speech, to support both speech therapists and BCBAs and to bridge this so that we're working together collaboratively. And most importantly, so that speech therapists don't feel alone, and that so BCBA clinic owners feel that they are supporting their speech therapists, because not everybody gets how to navigate this. And my main thing today is, you know, you don't have to go it alone. So why I set up this talk today is that in the next, 12 minutes, I am going to walk you through six areas that I cover in this new mentorship program that I'm offering. And then after that, I will open up the floor for questions. So we have a nice number of people here, almost 50, and I will open up the floor for questions so you can type in the chat your specific questions. And I've been providing this mentorship behind the scenes. Actually, in the spring, I did a talk called SLP Services in an ABA Setting. It was an ASHA and an ACE course, and we had 1,000 people register. It was very, very exhilarating. And it was a topic that people want to talk about. And so from that, I've started offering this mentorship, and I wanted to share a little bit more about what it looks like with you tonight. So what exactly does the mentorship include? The mentorship includes six 1-hour consultations with me, each lasting 1 hour in duration. And so these are used, let's say that you sign up today or tomorrow, let's say you sign up October 19th, you just have to use those six sessions within a year's time span, okay? Areas we cover are absolutely specialized for you and the questions that you have. And so I really, in that first meeting with you, and some of you I know because we've talked and you've emailed me or I've sent you an Instagram DM or we've hopped on a Zoom call, but I tailor these six sessions directly to you so that you are feeling more comfortable navigating your setting and that you are feeling great being a speech therapist in that setting and that you're not feeling alone, that you have a sense of community. So these are some general things that we cover, but I cover lots of things. It's definitely dependent on you, the speech therapist, or you, the clinic owner, and what's important to cover. So number one is the basics of ABA. If you're new to applied behavior analysis and you don't feel comfortable with the jargon and the words that are used, it can feel very confusing. If you're not sure what people are saying. Now, in the BCBAs have it in their ethical code that they won't use jargon, but when they're in the workplace, they're going to say these words. So this is something that I can help you feel more confident with those words. What is a man? What is a tact? What are a coex? And this is a little bit of an excerpt of a video I made about that.
Azigan and Dushnu, Arabinigun and the Voodoo, Narzibinuto.
Okay, so it can be overwhelming. And that's the big white Cooper book that you study to become a BCBA. Assessment. Let me know in the chat if you have ever given the VB map. The VB map is an assessment that is more from the behavioral side of things. And I was trained on it about 10 years ago. So I do a lot of training. So this is something, actually, I have one person I'm meeting with next week. And that's something that she wants to learn more is about the VB map. So some people have said yes, and a couple of people have said no. And so the VB map is a wonder. Usually I have a copy just like laying around. Oh, I see it. It's down here, but I'm not going to grab it. So the VB map is a wonderful assessment. And actually part of the assessment was done by a speech language pathologist, who's also a BCBAD PhD. Her name's Dr. Barbara Esch. And so in this VB map, there's an ECOICS assessment. And so this is something that oftentimes speech therapists and BCBAs start to talk. And somebody wrote and said, hey, you know, this kid is not yet speaking. They were given the VB map. And now the BCBA is programming verbal imitation. And I'm not sure exactly why that's happening. And I really don't think that's functional for my students. How do we advocate for ourselves in that situation? Because that probably isn't the most functional. We really need to work on those things together. We have so much information in that area. Another part that we might discuss are ECOICS. I might also just interchangeably, even though it's not the same thing, is, you know, verbal imitation. I want the student to be able to say certain things. And if a child doesn't produce these ECOICS during the assessment, maybe the BCBA is going to not collaborate with you, even though we should have a collaboration, especially for speech sound production. And we really need to be together on that. That's something that's so very important and really something that we as speech language pathologists can give so much guidance on as well. Somebody said, participate in many assessments where the BCBA is administering the VB map, however, use different assessments. Absolutely. And we as speech therapists have different assessments. The VB map is nice because it does give you some really great information about foundational skills. So even understanding how to interpret the VB map report and how can we work on these goals together? Because the VB map does give us really great information, especially if you have a student who's not yet speaking, who's not really going to be able to get a standardized score. And then you're left thinking, what do we work on? There's so much to work on. The VB map can shape up some of those different things. So ECOICS, does the speech therapist write the goal? Should the BCBA write the goal? How can we work on this together? Is it okay if the RBT is running trials for this as well? I've done this for 20 years, so I have a really great system on how do we work on ECOICS, how do we generalize them, how do we work on them in maintenance, and how do we generalize them to a natural environment session as well, because we know that's so important for our learners. Okay, area number four, goal development. Oh boy, goal development. It can be hard to know what communication goals should I set when the BCBA is writing goals for communication. Somebody has said, when I worked down in Austin, Texas, we had teachers that were very highly trained in ABA and the speech therapist, I was there to support them. I would go into the meetings once a month. I do a talk like this. And then the rest of the month, I visit them on campus. I love that job. And I would help them understand their role on the team because sometimes it can feel like there's too many cooks in the kitchen. You know, I'm writing this goal. They're writing this goal. Aren't these the same? Why are we writing the same goal? It's going to depend too on your funding source and things like that. Maybe you can do shared goals. Maybe you can have the same goal and work on it together. And how do we navigate goal development? And then just in general, if you've never worked with students, number one, who engage in problem behavior that's a barrier to learning, or number two, if you haven't worked a lot with students who are not yet speaking, who are emergent communicators and AAC, I help you understand how do we set goals so that there's not 15 goals, that there are a handful of goals and that we have a deep focus on this handful of goals that's going to help our students find their voice. This is just a little TikTok about how you have to gear yourself up before those IEP meetings. Hype yourself up, yeah. Okay, so sometimes you got to do that, right? You're sharing your part, BCBA's listening, outside consultant, all the things. All right, number five. The fifth area that I traditionally cover in the mentorship is AAC. So I have worked with a variety of different AAC programs and AAC devices over the past 20 years. And what's amazing about AAC is ever changing, but we need to make sure that everybody has a baseline understanding of the device. Everybody understands how to use the device and that you understand how to get support in your clinic. So I try to help you navigate that and understand when should we start AAC? What are the different types of AAC? How do I determine that this is important for my student at that time? So we discussed AAC in depth. The sixth and final area that I usually discuss in mentorship is service delivery. So how do I help a student by seeing them? Do I, you know, let's say I have a student who engages in unsafe behavior and I don't feel comfortable seeing them in my speech office. Can I go into the classroom? Should I see them in my office but request that a staff member come and only come if they're available? There's a lot that goes into that. We want to make sure, and it's different for every single student. And so we do a lot of coaching and support on, well, what does that look like? Some students get individual therapy. Can you go in and do a group? Group is great because you're modeling. Do all the students have one-on-one support? Do they need that? And what is that time going to look like? And so we talk a lot about that service delivery part. What if you're working with a student, they need social skills support. Maybe you help them with social skills instruction in your office, and then you go into the natural environment like recess or a time like that. And then you're helping to provide feedback and coaching too. So there's lots of different things that we talk about with service delivery, which is really dependent upon your environment, which everybody's company or clinic they work in is going to be different. So before mentorship, oftentimes people email me. I get emails almost every single day from a speech therapist or a speech therapy assistant, or that's feeling isolated, or that is writing a scenario and they're not sure how to navigate it. And they don't have anybody in their work environment to ask. Or sometimes I have BCBAs who own clinics and they want their SLPs to feel trained and they want their SLPs to feel like they can advocate for their students for communication within that environment. And they know that they can't help support their speech therapist because they're not a speech therapist. And so this is where this mentorship begins. And so before mentorship, we can feel stressed out. We can feel really alone and really isolated. And then during and after mentorship, we're feeling more comfortable. We're feeling like we can understand how to navigate this environment. So really, here is the secret to this talk. It's not just about understanding how to navigate your role in this ABA setting. It's actually about giving you the confidence to know you're not alone, that you're an expert in the area of communication, that you can collaborate with fellow professionals, that you can also advocate for your students, that you have an important role on the team. And you know that you are reaching each and every student on your caseload, and you feel supported doing so, which is so very key. So what does the mentorship include? And then I'm going to share with you a link to. It's 6 one-hour consultations with me that are guided towards what you feel are your areas that you would like to learn more about in this setting. So today I outlined 6 of them that are common ones that I cover in mentorship, but I can cover other things too. And that's what makes this so special, is that it really is your journey. When I started the talk, I said, where are you on your journey? So I'm able to help you in such a special way. So those 6 one-hour consultations cost $12.97. And I have a one-page sheet that I'm going to share with you. I'm going to stop my share now, and then I will take any questions. So usually people, if you are able to share this with your employer, they can hop on a discovery call with me too. So I do free calls, and I will let you know about that. Okay, so in the chat, I just shared the link that you could provide to your employer if this is something that you would like. And oftentimes your employer pays for this, not every time. I've done mentorship where the speech therapist is paying, or I've done mentorship where the clinic owner is paying, or the school district, and we take purchase orders too. So let me know in the chat if you have any questions. I will stay on here for a couple minutes to answer any questions that come up. Make sure that when you're putting them in the chat, that you're sharing the question with everybody so that I can read it aloud and answer your questions. And then tomorrow, I will email everybody that registered here for this. I will send you this one-page PDF guide, and I will also send you the discovery call link so that you can sign up, either yourself or your employer can sign up for a 15-minute call with me. And so I know some of you on the call today, I have already talked with. And so it's nice to see some familiar faces, not faces, names. So let me know if you have any questions, make sure that you type them here in the chat and I will stay on and answer your questions. And I will stay on for a minute or two. If nobody has any questions, that's totally fine too. The discovery call is nice too, just to talk about your current situation, to talk about where you are working and things like that. So Morgan said, do you have a rolling membership? I don't currently have a membership. That's something that I do want to do someday in the distant future, probably in the next couple of years, but I don't have a membership right now. So what I'm doing right now is stuff that's a little more intensive, kind of one-to-one consultations. Yeah, good question. Okay, Morgan. Yeah, that sounds great. So I will send you the one-page PDF guide, and then you will have that information. And this is a rolling onboarding. So every month I'm getting new people into the mentorship. And so this just starts whenever you're ready. And then you just have to use the 6 sessions by the 1-year mark. Yeah. Okay. Somebody said I'm taking an ABA class currently. Oh, that's wonderful. Yes. How wonderful. Yes. It's great to be duly certified. I really love that. And, yeah. I have another company called Supervision Academy, and we provide supervision for people becoming BCBAs. And I actually have somebody who joined our academy there, and she's been a longtime ABA speech supporter. So it's been fun to welcome her into that because I recognize her name. We've just talked on email and she's taken my courses and stuff. So yay. Okay, so make sure that you look in the chat and you can get that PDF guide. Hannah said, can you send that? I'm putting Supervision Academy there in the chat. And so that is our company where we provide supervision. And I've supervised quite a few BCBAs, which are people who became BCBAs, which is cool. Okay, Jacqueline said, do you have any other mentorship options? Yes, if you don't want to do the whole mentorship, you just want to do one consult, you can do one consult, absolutely. And that obviously costs less. So one consultation hour is $250. You just get a deal if you do the mentorship, and it's nice because you really, it's transformative and things like that. So Dana said, if an employer paid, would you be willing to work with 2 to 3 SLPs per employer? Yes, absolutely. We could do that. And I'm doing that right now with a kind of large staffing company. Training their speech therapists navigating ABA, kind of new to that. So yeah, Dana, absolutely. That would definitely be doable. Hannah said, can you provide more information on how to get certified? Yeah, so I'm actually taping a podcast about that on Wednesday, but it's going to come out in a little bit. And it is, you don't have to get a whole other degree anymore. Yeah, you want to visit this website, bacb.com. And it will give you all the information, but you do I think it's how I did it. You have to take 15 hours past your master's, and then you have to do supervision with somebody who's already a BCBA. And that's where Supervision Academy comes in. And then you have to take a test. Just like we took our SLP test, you have to take a test. But I think it's worth it. It gives you flexibility in your job too. So I'm really happy being duly certified. Good questions. Keep them coming. If anybody else has any questions, let me know. I'm here to support you. I know it's a lot of information to take in. I like the mentorship because I really get to know the speech therapists that are doing the mentorship, and it's really transformative for your career. You know, I know it's an investment, and I totally understand that. One consultation is great too, to start things off. And this is so much better than a CEU. You could definitely take a course about it, but being able to hash out what's really going on in your work setting and talk to somebody who's been there and who has done it. Yes. So Morgan, you can always contact me at my email, but I am going to send you tomorrow this recording, the one-page PDF, and then I'm going to send everybody who signed up for this my discovery link. I can actually get it right now. So I have a discovery link where you can sign up for a free 15-minute session with me. I'm going to grab it right now, and we can do a Zoom together. So, okay. So I just shared in the chat a link if you want to do a discovery call, which is a Zoom call with me, and ask about any other questions. Angela said, do you have any trainings for SLPAs and or RBTs? Hi, Angela, how's it going? This is applicable for, you know, I actually provide SLPA supervision in Washington State. So I've done that for 2 years and really love and enjoy it. So I understand, you know, how SLPA works and things like that. This would be applicable for that as well. You know, if your speech therapist and you as the SLPA wanted to do the mentorship, we definitely can do small group mentorship, probably up to about 4 people is probably the biggest group that we've done. And just wanting to make sure that everybody's getting their needs met and things like that. So if anybody has any other questions, pop them in the chat. So I will send you tomorrow this recording. I will send you the one-page PDF guide. I will send you the discovery link again if you didn't get it. And that will allow you to sign up for a free 15-minute Zoom call with me. And we can chat about your exact situation, where you need the support. And I hope that's very helpful. So thank you so much for tuning in, everybody. And if you have any questions before then, just shoot me an email or send me something on Instagram, because, you know, I'll be over there. And if not, I will send you an email tomorrow. Thanks so much for tuning in. And I hope that I will see